Greetings, Guardians, my name is Byfe here. We've discussed the Drifter as he features in Gambit and how he relates to the current lore in Destiny's world, but I want to take a moment today to delve into the past of this most enigmatic figure in the lore. Small note, I'm going to be in Memphis when this video is going live, so my apologies if I can't immediately respond to things, but I do hope you enjoy things regardless. I took a bit of feedback on the last video, and yeah, hopefully you guys notice a few improvements. Now, onto the lore. In this video, I want to take a little dig into the Drifter's past. I've mentioned a few details here and there when covering him in my first and second videos on this topic, but there are a few stories in particular that are worth talking about. I want to cover those in more depth today. For those of you that missed the last two videos, a brief summary. The Drifter was risen a few centuries ago and was immediately drawn to the outer edges of the system, away from the light of the Traveler. In his conversations with Shin Malfur, he states that he was drawn to the Other. In his time, the Drifter has clearly run with quite a few crews. Or perhaps he's simply lying about running with quite a few crews. If he has run with any crews at all, it's pretty clear that he outlasted them. He speaks as though he's traveled the entire system, and maybe he has, having visited a variety of locations past to the Reef, which generally are a lot harder for Guardians to reach. He also speaks about a variety of myths and folk tales that not everyone has heard of, saying that he's visited the fourth tomb of Nezarek, and having unearthed the riches of Exodus Prime are a few of the more interesting ones, although whether they're true or not is another question. Overall, his entire vibe is one of mystery, and his past is as he likes it, veiled in shadow. Until now. Now, there's one story in particular that really needs to be jumped into aside from all the general details, but I do think that before we do any of that, I need to give you a disclaimer that this is a story that is being recited by the Drifter to his ghost. It isn't at all clear how much of this is true, but it does hold a rather ominous set of possibilities if it is true. I'm not sure how much reason the Drifter would have to lie about any of these events in his records to his ghost, but he does talk as though he's giving these records to us, so we should remember, as always, what Shin Malfur has said many a time about the Drifter. Quite simply, we can't trust the Drifter. So, let's take a gander at what roads he's trodden. The following entries are in five parts, and they are taken from the Gambit Warlock set, and it talks about the Drifter and one of his old crews, and a very strange adventure that they had, which took them to a very, very dark place. I had a crew once, my best friends, which isn't saying much, trust me. They're all dead, almost to a man. So what does that mean for all you little Guardians out there who are my new best friends? Don't think about that one too hard. Anyway, my crew, or a little subset of it, we leave the system together. Dawn of the City Age at the time. We were looking for something greater than light, because we had seen that light can be a cause of so much strife. We searched far and wide, must have been hundreds of years. We found a planet beyond the system bristling with an energy that repulsed light. Naturally, we were curious. We landed, intended to settle and conduct the research necessary to make this energy portable. A weapon out of legend called Thorn had similar light-repressing capabilities. It seemed promising, but hand to my heart, it was cold. Humans were not meant for that place. Every once in a while, a member of the crew would succumb, died where they stood or sat. Thank the planes for our ghosts. We were in high spirits. We were veterans. Grizzled. Hundreds of years in space will do that. Drifter's thoughts recited to his ghost for posterity, the first of five parts. So they found a place so cold that they literally couldn't survive, which out in the wastes of empty space, far away from a local star, is not really too surprising. However, the thing that really scares me is the idea that the planet they visited had energy capable of repulsing light. Needless to say, it makes our minds really just wander straight to the darkness, and with good reason. The fact that these Guardians were searching for a weapon to rival the power of Thorn means that this crew might have been in the same kind of lines as the Shadow of Yore, aka one looking for darker powers, although that is mere speculation. What is very clear is that the crew was very interested in the possibility of being able to wield a weapon comparable to Thorn's power. The story next takes a darker turn as the Drifter and his companions discover something that will change their fate. So there we were, on that cold hunk of ice with no name, just me and my crew. Everything peachy keen. We discovered some kind of alien monolith, a facility left by the inhabitants of that planet long gone by then. But trapped inside was a creature, in a cage of some sort, frozen in ice. An exhibit? Was it some kind of zoo? Still not sure to this day. We should have brought a scientist. All we had were, well, guys who thought we looked tough in dark colors. During our long stay on that planet, we found many of these monoliths, each with their own captured creature. Anyway, this thing, the creature, looked like it shared common bioenergetics with the Hive, but there were no records then or since that I've ever seen of humanity's encounters with them. And the creatures had a property the Hive did not have. It produced a field that repressed light, like a darkness zone, but contained to a gooey, vacuous form with no head. The anti-light fields we had detected from orbit that spread across the planet? It was these things. Our ship's scanners indicated thousands of them were on this planet with us. We were ecstatic. In hindsight, we all could have done with a few less of them. So, this is the biggest question. What the hell are those things that they discovered? They share bioenergetics with the Hive, meaning that undoubtedly they can't be up to any good. But to see that thousands of these things are contained on the planet below is even more troubling. We see them contained in their icy prisons and the monoliths that contain those prisons, but to my knowledge, there aren't any similar acts made within Destiny's lore that can be used to contain a being like this, except for certain Hive souls which can be bound within crystals, which sometimes are chained up. Having said that, there's nothing there that indicates that these are the similar kind of conditions. The Drifter seems to indicate that this was all ice, nothing more. And even with that, it doesn't quite match the description that the Drifter gives. He gives the indication that these things have been caged and contained, not necessarily preserved and revered. It's also unclear whether these creatures here are being held to secure them from the previous inhabitants of the planet, or whether they're being held as a sort of weapon, or whether there's some other circumstance that explains why they are being bound in ice. Something that is worth noting, though, is that these creatures might have been seen before. What do I mean? Well, time to go back to the Treasure Island book. If any of you purchased the Taken King Collector's Edition, you'll remember that you got a Treasure Island book which fashioned itself as one of Cade's journals, and in that, there is an entry which talks about Cade's experience of what I believe was the darkness during the collapse. And what shows up in that book? Well, an image of a few things that look rather vacuous, flowing of darkness, and which, frankly, are lacking the distinctive shape of a head. Something that aligns a little bit more clearly with the image that the Drifter has conjured here. I don't want to jump to conclusions, but I would easily state that considering the fact that they are like a portable darkness zone, except contained to those forms, that these creatures have some kind of deeper tie to the darkness, and that whatever this world is, it certainly cannot mean anything good for us. So the Drifter has discovered this massive planet filled with beings that are literally capable of drowning out your light. But what happens next is going to be cause for even more concern. My crew and I quickly learned that the creatures in the monolith facilities were not the only ones on that damn rock. Plenty of them roaming around out in the wild, where it was cold, but less cold than the frozen cages that contained the ones in the monoliths. How'd we find out? Well, one of us died in our sleep. Not that uncommon or tragic, actually. Happened a lot. Damn cold out there. Except, this time, that fella's ghost couldn't resurrect him. Turns out one of those creatures just slithered by. In close proximity to it, from inside our shelter, just silenced that poor bastard's light. It was unfortunate, but it also lit a fire under us. The next morning, we realized we had a potential weapon on our hands that could change everything in battles of light versus light. We knew we had to find a way to get those creatures off their icy home, and we needed to find it fast. Despite our breakthrough, tensions were a little high. Some of us thought it was awful convenient the creatures wandered by and happened to take out only one of us, and so soon after we realized the value of them. If the creatures weren't ominous enough in the first place, now they sound like even more of a terrible threat. Being able to silence someone's light and suppress it is bad enough, but having them roam around on the planet is far more terrifying as far as possibilities go. When they're contained to the monoliths, they can be somewhat controlled. But when they are roaming around, slithering past defenses, and potentially leaving the light bearers bereft of the thing that means they can always come back from death, they become a far more ominous presence. However, the Drifter's purpose and the purpose of his crew is made much more clear here. They want to weaponize the darkness of these creatures and use it against the light. Again, it's another potential nod at the shadows of yore, but confirming anything here, once more I will simply say is a mistake. There's a few things that I'll talk about later that don't really match up with the chronology perfectly, so we'll have to wait and see. Tensions start to run a little high amongst the group, and those tensions soon boil over, as we'll read in this next transcript. I mentioned tension was high among the crew in the last one, right? That's what I thought. Well, it got worse. Another one of us died. In the exact same way, even after we took up residence in one of the monoliths. Idiot just froze to death, his ghost too whacked out by light repression to do anything about it. Died in his sleep. The others were not happy about it. I was not happy about it. We'd been looking for a way to contain the creatures. The monoliths seemed to have some kind of freeze tech, if you could call it technology, that we could use if only we could replicate it. I'm a pretty savvy mechanic, but we couldn't figure it out. We started to blame each other. Someone must have lured one of those things near crew quarters. To this day, I still don't know for sure. Why kill just one of us? For what? It was more plausible that the creature did it knowingly, a punishment for our intrusion. But there was no malice there that we could detect, only biology. At the time, we didn't care. Eventually, one of them drew a gun. I knew it would happen, and I had prepared a soothing speech to smooth things over just in case. Told them to host that smoke wagon, and the next time any of them tried it again, I'd kill them all without a second thought. I didn't speak plainly often, but when I did, even that crew listened. It's been an extended period of time now, and the Drifter and his crew are starting to lose it. The interesting question raised here is whether the creatures are actually aware of their effect on the crew of Guardians. It could be the case that they're maliciously affecting the team in order to weaken their resolve and to split them apart. Maybe their deaths are the only things that matter to them. However, there is also, as the Drifter suggests, just a chance that it's mere biology, and that the creatures are maybe not even intelligent enough to be aware of their function, or of the fact that they are draining the light of those individuals that they walk close enough to. Finally, however, we get an idea of what the time frame of these events is like with the final entry, and we get an idea of how long the Drifters run with this crew, potentially. We were at our wits' end. A year on the planet, and we had been completely unable to capture or tame the creatures that had become our sole objective. They were our bane. Our ship had long been rendered useless by the extreme cold. We'd all died 100,000 times over to the cold. I know you've all been in the Crucible, played Gambit. This was worse. Much worse. Anyway, four of us were left. We were raving psychos at this point. Only the four of us and the howling wind and icy slopes for company, the occasional scurrying, vacuous creature to argue about. One day, when we had settled in for the night in another monolith, something swept over the planet. I later learned it swept across the system. All of you hearing this felt it. You were there at the source. All four of us lost our light, and we knew it. We looked over at the monolith creature in its frozen cage. It seemed to stare right back. I think I mentioned we were all raving psychos at this point. Well, we did what all measured raving psychos would do. We thought we each had been betrayed by the others. We drew on each other. To this day, I'm not sure how many of those guys intended to kill, but I'll tell you this, I was the only one who walked out. The creature in that monolith watched it all. When it was over, I stuck a finger straight up at it. It was just me now. How'd I get from there to here? Maybe I'll get to tell that story someday. We'll see if my gambit makes it that far. So the time frame of all this is potentially really important once again, because there are more potential clues about who the Drifter might have been running with. The Shadows of Yore are clearly something that's, relatively speaking, more contemporary in Destiny's lore, only really coming to prominence for us, at least, in Rise of Iron, and before that they had to have existed within the time span upon which the Crucible was created. Admittedly, not all of it, seeing as Dredgen Yore's legend rose through the Crucible. It means again that the Shadows are, relatively speaking, a contemporary part. It puts the beginning of the City Age, that time frame within which the Drifter talked about the crew first leaving the system, to be a very interesting point at which he could potentially have crossed paths with the individuals known as the Shadows. Maybe this was his time running with them. And this is also not taking into account the fact that Shin's records point to the fact that at one point, the Drifter did run with the Shadows of Yore, hence why he turned up on his radar in the first place. All of this matters and is made clear in the entry because all the Guardians lose their light, meaning that we know this is a contemporary timing. This is something that literally puts it within a year or two of where we are now. Does that completely solidify the timeline? Not even slightly, but again, whilst I cannot confirm everything here, it does point a few more fingers in the direction that this may have been the Shadows of Yore. And keep in mind that there were many reasons why Shin couldn't track all of the Shadows of Yore down, including the fact that many of them had split up and simply weren't on a single trail. Shin was trying to track one group, but found himself in trouble when he found that there were multiple individuals that had split courses. Hence why the Drifter noting that he had taken a subset of the crew is an important detail. Again, nothing is confirmed here, and it would be wrong to state that the Drifter was at this time traveling with the Shadows, but it seems more and more likely. This entry, needless to say, is timed at the start of the Red War, meaning that, of course, while all of this is contemporary, the Drifter's change and the introduction of Gambit, as well as potentially Shin's own records of the Drifter, may all have happened within the last year, which sheds a little bit of interesting light on both of the characters, meaning that they have indeed been active within the contemporary timeline of Destiny's history. Again, it's all really fascinating if you're trying to frame what these characters were doing, but there's still a lot of grey area here. We don't know every detail. Now, if we are to believe that the Drifter did kill all the members of his crew instead of sparing them, and if he was running with the Shadows, it might also explain his later actions of letting Shin Malfur find Callum. It's a story we'll cover in the Malfescence quest, but it's one of those little moments where you sit there and think that if the Drifter betrayed the crew, and then betrayed their leader to Shin, perhaps it's one of those moments where he thought that he wouldn't be welcome back, and that it was better to cut ties now. An interesting idea, but again, nothing to be confirmed. We need to see where the writing team is going to take this one. And there's a lot more that I think we'll be getting when the Last Word quest drops, and when we get to Joker's Wild. In the meantime, there are some persistent questions, but one of the most important ones is how the Drifter got off that rock, frozen ice, and terrible dark creatures. The answer is one that he states he'll tell us another time, but what the lore here does suggest is that it was on this place, this barren rock, that he found the artifact being towed by his ship. In his conversations with Shin, he talks about how he found it out in a place so cold it could smother our light. That fits the description of the planet described in the entries in the Warlock armor pretty well. So I think we can be content in the knowledge that it is indeed here that he somehow lassoed himself a portion of the Ascendant Realm. Which, of course, now raises only more questions about how the hell he did it. Did he return here with tech from around the system? Did he find it in the process of his escape? Did he somehow exploit the creatures on the planet? There are a whole host of possibilities in the time between then and now, and the honest answer at the moment is that we just don't know any of them. However, during the course of this video, we've raised a fair number of mentions of another important topic that we're going to be covering next, namely the Shadows of Yore. But before doing that, there's going to be an ancillary lore video to all of this, which is really back on the main storyline of Destiny. Before we go ahead and talk about the Shadows of Yore, we need to cover the entire history of the most famous rivalry in all of Destiny. We're going to need to talk about a tale of three men, of Shin, Jaren, and Razel, of the man with the golden gun, and to the remnants of a once noble man. We're going to need to talk about the rose that became something more. To talk about smoke that rose from the iron on someone's hip. Next time, we're going to tell the story of Thorn and the Last Word. Expect that to be a very, very long video. And tell me now if you want me to read everything or if you want a summary of some kind. And if possible, I'll see about getting art for that one, but no promises. This one was kind of a tricky one for me to even approach because you know something? I've tried making this video series before and we got places and then the lore evolved even more and maybe I can use some of the art that Stefan Sejic has put forward to this before, but again, it's a very interesting topic and an interesting area. So, in the interests of getting it right, I may take a little bit more time on this, but we will continue the story of Drifter, Gambit, and soon to be the Shadows of Yore. In the meantime though, thank you so much for listening to this video, and if you did enjoy it, please hit the like button. If you want to hear more Destiny content just like this, then please go ahead and hit subscribe as well, and hit the bell next to subscribe to turn on those email notifications. But of course, know that all of this is quite unnecessary and that your viewership, as always, is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Purodasia ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.